Okay, hope you got all of that. Good morning. It's still morning, is it? Is it not? We've already had a service one time, and so this is round two. Thank you for being here. My name is Dave. I don't know if you know me or I know you. With the light in my eyes, I don't even know if I can see you. But my wife is normally with us, with me. She's in Italy right now. I just got back from a three-week trip to Indochina, serving, and then I had 2 days with my wife. She got on a plane and went to Italy, and now she's serving there for 2 weeks. I was doing leadership development and church planning. My wife is working with another gal in our church in the sex trafficking area. I don't know if you have any knowledge of that. It's actually San Diego. This is a significant problem for us locally. Several people I know are involved in rescue or rehabilitation and renewal of people that have been taken captive by somehow in the sex industry. It's actually an industry. It's larger than drugs now, which is kind of gives you an idea of just how prevalent it is worldwide. So we're going to pray in just a moment, and I'd appreciate it you join with me when we do, and we'll pray for my wife Kim and Joyce Zick, who's also a member of our church here. Today, after really seeking diligently God's mind on what he would have us to consider together, the title of my message is Christ's Extravagant Love. My wife immediately told me, you know, even from Italy, is correcting me or challenging me on my word choice. She said to her, that just means a waste, which of course cannot be what I mean. That is one meaning of extravagant. What I'm intending by that is that in Christ's extravagance, the idea that something that's extravagant pushes beyond the boundaries of reason, of reasonableness. And that's what I mean by that. And I mean that because that's what Paul tells us in this paragraph that we're going to look at, which is a prayer that he offers on our behalf as God's children, that Christ's love is so great, so deep, so wide, so high, so profound, so beautiful, so awesome, so powerful, that we'll just never, ever get our minds around it adequately in our temporal state. So that's what we're going to look at this morning. The Revelation passage is a little bit of a snapshot of what it looks like for us when Christ puts us in a place with him so that we can fully experience his love. And it's described for us in Revelation 20, actually chapter 21 and 22. We're just going to look at the first four verses. So let's read both of those passages together, Ephesians 3. Let me open my Bible because I can't quite get the angle. Ephesians 3, verses 14 through 19. You have to back up to verse 13 because verse 14 starts, as you see, for this reason. So he's continuing a previous thought. In verse 13 says, I ask that you don't lose heart over what I'm suffering for you, which is your glory. And so what Paul's obviously implying is that there's discouragement, there's confusion, there's some doubts that have crept into the believers' lives because of things that are going on with him. And you probably know that Paul is writing from prison, do you not? And so he is in a difficult situation, and that's causing some real trouble for the believers that have been influenced by Paul's life and teaching. So because of that, Paul says, I want you to know something, that I am praying, I am going to the Lord, bow on my knees before the Father, from whom every family in heaven and on earth is named, so that according to the riches of his glory, he may grant you to be strengthened with power through his Spirit in your inner being, so that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith, that you, being rooted and grounded in love, may have strength to comprehend with all the saints what is the breadth, length, height, and depth, and to know the love of Christ that surpasses knowledge, and that you may be filled with the fullness of God. Revelation 21, verses 1 through 4. Let me turn and read that to you. The Apostle John now sharing through a revelation that he received from Christ. Now I saw a new heaven and a new earth. For the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and the sea was no more. And then I saw the holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And then I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, "Behold, the dwelling place of God is with man. He, that is God, will dwell with them, and they will be his people. And God himself will be with them as their God, and he will wipe away all tears from their eyes. And death shall be no more, neither shall there be mourning, nor crying, nor pain anymore, for former things have passed away." This is the word of God. Join me in praying, if you would, please. Father, we just pause for a moment, but before we look at your word together, Lord, we're a diverse group in the issues of what has happened in our lives in the past few days, few hours. Maybe the things that burden us, even in this moment, undoubtedly a wide range of things going on in each of us, and certainly in all of us together. So, Lord, we can't possibly know your mind and how you see each one of us in your presence right now. But we do know that we're not here by some act of fate or chance, not by accident. Certainly, we made decisions and had to take certain responsibilities and say no to some other things to be here. But through all of those things, you were at work bringing us to this point. God, we want this to be a spiritually rich and meaningful time. We don't want to just run like a hamster in a circle around an endless wheel. God, we want Sunday worship desperately to hear from you. We long for your fellowship. We long for your presence and your grace, your active presence in our lives. God, we need your strength. We need your counsel. We need your family that you have put around us, and so much more. So God, take the passage that you have directed me as your servant to, and use it to minister to each one of us uniquely. In Christ's holy name we pray, amen. The paragraph, I don't know if you've ever done a study on the prayers of the New Testament. It's quite a remarkable study. I would commend it to you. Paul is constantly praying for other people. Prayer for others is a very major theme, motif throughout the New Testament. You can see, for instance, even in the book of Acts, the Acts of the Apostles. Remember in chapter 6, because of the effect of the gospel, people are coming to Christ, and whenever people are being changed by the gospel, it creates a need to organize resources as that growth continues to widen and affect more and more people. And that's happening in Acts 6. Maybe you're familiar with that passage where there's a criticism, a grumbling that is going on because one particular nationality is accusing another particular nationality of favoring them, their own group, and overlooking another group. Sounds familiar, doesn't it? Somebody would be showing favoritism to someone else. Happens in every age. Well, that's happening in the New Testament. And so those that were the Hellenists were saying, and of course that meant that they were Greek-speaking Jews, that they were being overlooked in favor for those that were Jews who spoke Hebrew and Aramaic. And so that became quite the controversy. The significance of all that, though, is much more deeper than just a relational issue or a racial issue or an ethnic issue or a national issue. The real thing that was hanging in the balance was the march of the gospel. And that's what God was carrying out, the growth of the kingdom. He was bringing, spreading the word of the story of Christ all around the Roman Empire. The gospel is moving westward because of the apostles. And suddenly there came this halting stop, the sudden stop, because of a mismanagement or a failure to manage adequately resources that was a need that arose because of the success of the gospel. Very much about similar to what happens today. So not Paul, but other writers at that time, of course, Peter is there and is commanding a lot of leadership. And so he pulls the other apostles around him and they make a decision that is a decision that is intended to guard something. And what they're trying to guard is prayer. You know, sometime read the passage. Because the concern on God's part is that the people that should be devoted to praying for others, those who have people under their charge, are not praying. Instead of praying, they're scurrying about, serving meals, making meals, cleaning up probably from the meals, doing things that are certainly not bad things to do, certainly necessary things to do, but in this case, not the things that please God. And so they organized for the first time a group of people called deacons. And it's interesting, the word diakonos literally means to stir up the dust. It's to go through the dust. It kind of creates its own image that these are a group of people that are scurrying around to address the physical resources that must be addressed because of the advance of the gospel. And so that is the first one of the first times you see in the New Testament where prayer is profoundly important. Of course, even prior to that, you find the 120 in the upper room praying together. I mean, there's just all through the book of Acts, God's people pause to pray. And then when you get to Paul's epistles, he is constantly mentioning prayer in his introduction. That you remember he's praying constantly for the Philippians. He's praying always for those in Corinth, he's praying for those in Galatia. He's praying for those in Rome. He's always mentioning that prayer is a dominant part of his life. So then, with that background, we come into Ephesians. And one of the things that we've already run into a couple of times in Ephesians is Paul's mentioning love in connection to the ministry and the life and ministry of Jesus Christ. In the first chapter, he says, in love, we were predestined in Christ by God. And so love, Christ's love for us, is the foundation, it is the explanation as to why we have been redeemed by God, included in as a part of his elect. You get into chapter 2, it says, because of the great love with which he has loved us, we have been born again. We have gone from death to life. And so he again emphasizes not the planning part of redemption, but the experience of redemption as an individual. So not only has God in all eternity planned redemption for those that are identified as the elect in Ephesians 1, we have experienced that redemption as individuals. And in both cases, whether it's in the macro or the micro, it is explained on the basis of Christ's love for us, God's love to us through Jesus Christ. And then we get to chapter 3. And here in chapter 3, Paul now is talking about his own life just briefly, letting us know that he is aware, that they are aware, that he has fallen under difficult times, that he's been arrested, that he's been put in jail. He's either in house arrest or he is perhaps even in a what would be similar to a jail that we would know, except a lot more Spartan, a lot more difficult. Knowing that, Paul then pauses to address a great need in their lives. And the need, as he sees it, is for them to grow in their understanding of Christ's love once again. That really should be no surprise to us that Paul would think that way. We have read that Paul's saying that the love of Christ constrains him. So Paul understands that it is Christ's love that gives him an understanding of how it is that he should live and how he shouldn't live. He talks about Christ's love when it comes to being resilient and enduring and steadfast when it comes to trials. He talks about Christ's love already, as I said, when it comes to redemption. He talks about Christ's love when it comes to gaining an idea as to how we are to live ourselves and the choices we are to make. He talks about Christ's love when it comes to forgiveness and reconciliation, not only to God, but to one another as on a horizontal plane. He talks about Christ's love as the compelling thing that causes you and me to love each other in a certain way. In Ephesians chapter 4, a chapter later, he's going to talk that way, that we should love one another as Christ loves us. We should forgive one another as Christ forgives us. So Paul thinks very, very frequently, in fact, pervasively, his thought rests upon the importance and the power, that life-transforming power of knowing and growing in your knowledge of the love of Christ. So that's what this little prayer is all about. So the first question I want to pose to you and then answer is, so why is it that Paul finds this so important? And I'm going to answer it with a negative, in that if you look at the New Testament and the kind of battles that Paul is facing and that believers are facing, you realize that there is great spiritual opposition to the love of Christ. Paul in Romans chapter 8 talks about there is this person, there is this personality, this who that might not separate us from the love of Christ. I think that he's indicating there that that is a big focus of spiritual warfare, that Satan's great goal is for you not to grow in your understanding of the love of Christ. I don't know if you're a baseball person. You probably don't need to be a baseball person to know what an intentional walk is, I guess. You know, that somebody comes up to the plate to hit, and instead of receiving pitches where he could hit the ball, in professional baseball, they'll just, you know, you'll see him do this. Now they speed up the game by just waving the batter down to first base. It's interesting. You can kind of diagnose how teams think about the skill level of a hitter by the amount of intentional walks that he has received. And there are people in the history of the game that have received an enormous amount of intentional walks because of the great respect they have for his power and his influence on the game. Barry Bonds, even though all the controversy that hangs over him, Barry Bonds, if you take the top four people, seasons and intentional walks, Barry Bonds is the highest single season, the second highest single season, the third highest single season, until finally you get to fourth place and it's somebody, Willie McCovey. When it comes to the amount of intentional walks in a career, the next person behind Barry Bonds is less than half of what he received. There's a guy named Ricky Henderson. You'd probably have to really be a baseball player to remember that name because he's not been around for a while. But Ricky Henderson was lethal in baseball for a lot of reasons. He was a great hitter. He was a base stealer. I mean, he just had all kinds of tools to kill you as an opponent. Well, Ricky Henderson received more than 2,500 walks in his career. More than 500 than the guy who was second place in that. And the reason for it is the great respect, the great power that people thought Ricky Henderson, Barry Bonds had to be a game changer. Well, the same thing, that same principle holds true when it comes to the love of Christ. Satan knows, the world knows, even your flesh is a part of that battle, that the love of Christ is a game changer. It is something that has in it the God instilled power to make us into something else. That something else that God wills for us to be, that God needs for us to be in order to build his kingdom. That's the kind of thing that we're talking about. And the value of that, the significance of that to God is reflected in the great opposition that it receives from that which is against God and those that are against God. So that's why it's so important. How do we grow in our appreciation of Christ's love for us? Well, one thing should be very obvious. Paul starts out in the paragraph, "For this reason I bow my knee before the Father." The most significant way that you and I grow together in our understanding of Christ's great love for us is through prayer. And here, the example is not Paul praying for himself, but Paul praying for others. Now, I just want you to pause and think about that for a second, because, it's not uncommon for people in a church to have, we're all Americans, we have opinions about everything, we measure everything, we gauge everything against something else. The music just now is, you're going to measure it against music somewhere else. Sour voice, you're going to measure against somebody with a sweet voice. And so we're just like that. We're incurable consumers, you and I. We're always looking for the best product for the least price is what we're doing. And comparing, it's almost like you're doing church Yelp shopping sometimes, the way our culture works. And that's understandable because it is the air we breathe, consumerism. But in that consumerism, I think what sometimes gets lost is that the real thing that changes your life, first of all, is Christ. And the way that Christ goes about changing your life, according to our text here, is in response to those that are praying for you. Those who know you and care for you and have a deep enough commitment to you to faithfully pray for God's work in your life every day. I don't know if you do that. I know that you may, it's common to hear somebody talk about praying for someone to be saved. I've done that. My parents were not believers until I was in my 50s, and they were quite a bit older, of course. I prayed for them for years that they would come to Christ. I would have to confess, though, and I would wonder if this is true of you as well, I'm not as faithful to pray for my brothers and sisters in Christ to grow and to gain a deeper appreciation for the love of Christ. See, when Paul comes at this, it is a very serious matter on his heart, a very weighty thing to him. It is at the very pinnacle of how he thinks about what he has to offer the church. His prayer for you and me, that we would grow in our understanding of Christ's love for us. You can hear his seriousness in his tone as he starts, "I bow my knee before the Father." With great humility, great passion, great earnestness, I come before God, pleading with God that he would do something for someone else. And the thing that Paul wants to have happen that only God can do is to reveal Christ's love to us. He goes on to say, it's not just that I'm humble and earnest and sober in my approach to God. I'm approaching the one being who has all of the power that is necessary to actually bring about change in people's lives. Then he goes on to describe God that way. He is the one from whom every family in heaven on earth is named. That sounds like an odd turn of phrase to you and me, and it is. When's the last time you heard somebody say that coming out of the movies? Well, this is the person from whom every name on earth has come. It's you don't talk that way even about God typically. The simple idea that Paul is trying to convey is the greatness of God's power. He is the source of all things. He is the source of life. He is the source of mankind. He is the source of all that happens to his image bearers, men and women and children of his creation. And so God has that power to do what Paul is seeking for him to do. And he's acknowledging that. Paul knows he's tipping his hand by his humility and his bowing his knee that he knows he does not have that power. But he also is acknowledging with great praise that God has that power to do what needs to happen. And only God can do this. Again, think about how we are in our culture. We're, again, in not just incurable consumers, we're incurable pragmatists. You and I find it very difficult to see a need and not respond to that, to see a problem and not go about, at least even mentally, immediately trying to concoct a solution to it. I know I'm that way, and my wife would like me to be less that way when she's sharing a problem with me, or certainly less quick on the trigger to talk to her about solution. And sometimes I'm that way with Kim's that way with me. But we're both constantly thinking about solutions. I find it difficult. I don't know if you do. Do you find it difficult to be around someone who's always talking problem and never solution? I do. I find it difficult to respect people sometimes that are that way. I remember me feeling that one of the highest praises I ever received from one of my former bosses, John MacArthur, is that he said, "Dave, the difference between you and my other employees, you come with 3 problems, but you also come with 30 solutions." I thought, man, that's what I want people to think about me. I want to be someone that's a problem solver and who can come at issues and needs very directly and very quickly. It's not a bad thing. I think that can be a strength and has been a strength in my life and possibly yours. But it's also something that can be a great obstruction to my understanding of my weakness and my neediness. It can be a great hindrance to patience on my part to seek Christ and to plead with him to do something that I know deep in my heart, that no matter what I can control about the circumstance, I can't control the state of another person's soul. Right? I mean, it's just hard to be that way and really maintain the appropriate sense of God's greatness when it comes to expanding in my heart an understanding of Christ's love for me. Even as I talk to you about it, it's hard even in a message like this because I'm not really giving you anything to do. It's a lot easier to preach a message and say, okay, here's what the word says, and here's 3 things to go out and do. This one, really, there's only 1 thing to do, and that's to begin to pray for people that you love, that God would show them a deeper understanding of the love that Christ has for them. And that's what Paul is doing here. How many of you in here are parents? Raise your hand. Yeah. Well, Kim and I, when we were going to have our first child, we bought a whole shelf of parenting books. I don't know if you did that. We attended parenting conferences. We went and met with people that had children and had them for some time in various ages. When we had our second child, I took the parenting books from the kind of the eye level shelves and put them down lower. When we had our third child, I took them out to the garage. When we had our fourth child, I just burned them. It's like whatever it is that I need to do or whatever I'm hoping that God's going to do in my children, I don't think it's in these books. And Kim and I, though, there's a lot of practical things to be learned and a lot of helpful things to be gained from other people's experiences. We realize that really the only one that can change our children's hearts is God and nobody else. We can provide an environment in our home that is conducive and attractive to godliness, but we cannot flip a switch. How many times I've said to my wife, I just wish God would give me a bank of toggle switches and that whenever something happens in one of our children, I could just flip the switch and make it go the direction that I want it to go, but I can't. And there's a world of difference, an eternity of difference between being responsible as a friend, as a leader, as a parent, and being sovereign. And sometimes it's hard for me to keep that difference distinct in my own mind. Perhaps you as well. Well, Paul's very clear on this. He knows that God would have him to plead on behalf of other believers. But that pleading does not bring about change. Paul lets us know very clearly that the only one that can change another person's heart is God. So he goes on to say that according to the riches of his glory that he may grant strength and power through his spirit in the inner being. So Paul is saying through his glory, in the greatness of God's power, which is utterly unique in all the universe, God is the one that can bring about needed change in people's hearts so that they will see in a fuller and richer and more wonderful way the love of Jesus Christ. To do that, God is going to pull in another member of the Trinity. He's going to pull in the Holy Spirit. And he mentions that there. One of the ministries of the Holy Spirit, according to Paul here in this prayer, is that he is at work pulling back the curtain so that I get a wider view, a deeper view, a more dazzling, bright view of Christ's love for me. And he acknowledges that here. Another thing that Paul says, that in using the Holy Spirit, God brings about two specific things that are changes in a believer's life. He calls the one change, or labels it, strengthening, and the other power. And those are not synonyms. Those are very different ideas that Paul is conveying there. To be strengthened is to grow up. It is to mature. It is to go from training wheels to no training wheels. Our next door neighbor yesterday, or day before yesterday, Malia, little Filipino girl that is the only child right now, though our neighbor's Sarah's pregnant, but she's got this sweetheart, and we've seen her grow up, and we've seen her go through all these little initial phases from beginning to walk, beginning to play out in the courtyard area where we live. And a couple of days ago, I came out, and she said, Dave, look, no training wheels. And, you know, it's just a natural part of human life to develop. Well, Paul is saying that kind of growth should also take place in the spiritual world for you and me. He says that, he describes us here, interestingly enough, as those who are rooted and grounded in God's love. It's a fascinating thing that he does there, and it's a very important thing that we understand it correctly. What he's telling us here is that the people that he knows in his heart, that the people that he is praying for, are people that know Jesus Christ. That's what he's saying. They are already rooted and grounded in the love of Christ. He uses participles, what would be called in Greek attendant circumstance participles, which is a long, fancy, confusing way to say, this is something that I know is true while I'm doing this praying. So the people that he has in mind are redeemed people, Paul says. I know that you know Christ. I know that he is to you, to some degree, precious. I know that you have an awe at some level in your soul of who he is and what he has done for you on your behalf, with at no cost to you, no effort on your part, merely by grace through faith. See, he's saying that he knows that's who we are. But he's telling us that even though a greater knowledge of Christ's love for us follows redemption, it does not follow redemption automatically. It doesn't just happen. It happens in certain ways. And Paul's saying the two ways that he is sharing with us at this moment is, one, because people are praying for me that will in fact happen. We pray for a lot of things, do we not? I'm on Facebook. I don't know if you're on Facebook. I have a newsletter. I'm talking about my trip. I was all over Indochina. I was in 6-8 different cities, meeting with dozens, hundreds of people. And I was constantly asking people to pray for me. But typically what I was asking them to pray for were very specific, very concrete things. We were talking about an issue that we ran into with weather. Please pray for me because of the difficulty of communication because of the issue of language, my language and theirs. I was asking for people to pray for me for a translator. I was asking for us for prayer because one of our team members got sick from something that I mean, there were all kinds of things, and those are kind of typical things, and those are things that God would have us to pray. Give us our daily bread is not a wrong thing or a sinful thing or an immature thing to pray. It's not that that's a problem. It's that it occupies so much of our thinking that we never get to the kind of prayer that Paul is praying here. Lord, I'm praying that you would show my wife, that you would expand in her thinking the beauty of Christ's love. How often have you prayed that for someone that you care about? I know that I struggle doing that. I'm such a consumer, such a pragmatist, such a problem solving, that it's just difficult to just say, wait a second, there's nothing I can do here. And this is the Apostle Paul saying that about himself. And I'm certainly not the Apostle Paul, and neither are you. inspired of the Holy Spirit. So if you want someone to change, if you desire desperately for someone to grow in Christ, if you want them to see and experience victory over some habit of sin, some addiction that has attached itself to them, if you want to see them grow so that they quit thinking immaturely and autobiographically and carnally, if you want to see a relationship restored between you and a person that someone has hurt, or maybe both of you have hurt each other, if you want to see your marriage grow stronger and your children rise up and call you blessed and pass on the faith to the next generation, to their children, and their children to their children, should we not be praying the way Paul prays? God, make your son's love more beautiful, more wonderful in my child's heart than anything else that would possibly compete with him. God, make work in my husband, work in my wife's heart so that she sees Christ with new eyes, with eyes of understanding, with eyes of wisdom and knowledge, with eyes of humility, with eyes of that see his greatness and the grace of his love. See, that's what Paul's saying here. This is the important thing that we do for each other, is to pray that Christ would reveal himself and his love for each of us. So he goes on. He's not done. He says a few more things. So he says that prayer is it. He says that maturity is a part of how God expands our knowledge of Christ's love. And of course, what does that imply? If strengthening is a growing process, you realize, of course, that as in all cases of growth, growth is not something that occurs instant. It is something that takes place over time. And it's usually not just time that does it. It is time plus certain sets of experiences, certain kinds of experiences. So I believe that's exactly what Paul is indicating here. That you grow in deeper appreciation of someone's love for you, the longer you're around them and relate to them, and the more varied and the more weighty even the circumstances are that the two of you share together. Kim and I have been married, I can say this because she doesn't even look 36 in my judgment, but we've been married 36 years. 36 years. I mean, I know I look old enough to do that, but Kim does not. 36 years. And not too long ago when our daughter got married, they'd been married 6 months and they were having a little bit of a, you know, 6 month tussle. And so the two of them sat down with Kim and me and talked about how hard it is to love each other. And I said, 6 months? This is a little disconcerting here. And I said, although I do remember at 6 months, your mother and I had a kind of a knockdown drag out, as they would say in West Virginia, not literally, but metaphorically. And I said, you know, after 36 years, though, there is so much more that I know about your mom. So much more, so many more experiences I've seen her in. I've observed her in. Observed her when she was caring for her mother who was dying of cancer. Observed her when we went through two miscarriages, one into the second trimester. Observed her when she was coming alongside friends of hers and her sister who was having struggles. Observed her when she got a bad report from the doctor, when I went through multiple surgeries. And I've watched my wife and all of those things. And as a result of that, I have such a greater, deeper, wider appreciation of her love, not just for certainly first and foremost for God, but not just for God, but for me, and not just for me, for her family, and not just for her family, for people that she knows. See, that's what Paul is saying here. That's how God does that, is that he puts you in circumstances that require you to turn to him. Because in that circumstance, you realize what God knew all along, that you're outmatched by life. And only God is the one who can bring about the changes that really would honor him in this situation. So that's strengthening. So Paul says, look, God, do what you always do over a period of time. Drag people through circumstances. Sometimes very good circumstances are the way God grows us. Very prosperous circumstances at times, but often not. It is the trial that God uses. And the second thing that Paul says, not only does God use strength, he uses power. And the word power there has the idea to it of capacity or enablement. So as you're going through all these circumstances over time and you're learning more and more about Christ and you're finding yourself turning to him quicker and with more passion and more zeal and earnestness for him to intervene in your life, there comes to you as a consequence this bent, this reflex that you didn't have before. Instead of relying on picking up the phone when something bad happens and you receive undesirable news, instead of picking up the phone immediately to call a friend and just talk about it, or when your husband and you or your wife and you or your brother and you or your sister and you or your boss and you have a fight, rather than jumping on the phone or taking someone aside and finding a comrade, someone to be on your team against this person, you go to God. Because you know that God is the one that can actually make the situation what it ought to be. And only God can do that. That's what Paul is saying here. That as God works in us, he works through time and circumstance so that we learn to love Christ more deeply. He works in us in such a way that habits change, tendencies change, reflexes change, so that we have this growing ability, enablement, to turn to Christ before we turn to ourselves or to other people. It's a wonderful thoughts that Paul is sharing. But he's not done. He goes on to say, so not only does God bring about this growing appreciation of Christ's love for us through our prayers for each other, but also because of things that God does, and one is time, one is circumstance. But the other Paul mentions here, listen to what he says, that we would know, along with all the saints, that we would comprehend, verse 18, with all the saints, what is the breadth, length, and height. So Paul's, again, indicating to us another way that God brings us about in us. It's just not within our home, but is within our church, our community of faith. That God uses the community of faith in very unpredictable ways, sometimes in ways that we are not wanting to take place, to help us to learn more about Christ's love for us. I have no idea how faithful you are at church. Some of you I know, I see, I recognize. You may not recognize me. That's okay, too. I mean, I don't know that we bump into each other. That's one of the downsides, I guess, about two morning services. You don't ever see everybody at one time. But whether you're faithful or not faithful at coming to church, I have no idea. In 36 years of marriage and 40 years of Christian service, I cannot imagine not being a vital part, an engaged part of a local church. It just doesn't cross my mind. It doesn't cross Kim's mind. It is so much a part of our DNA as individuals and as a family to look for a church that we can be a part of and get to know people, to be a part of a community group, to be a part of different ministries, to be a part of hospitality where you get to meet all kinds of people. Not because I like making coffee on Sunday morning really early, not because I think I'm really good at arranging cups and napkins, but because that's a good way to connect with people. Because in that initial connection is the possibility of a deeper connection. And that deeper connection has in it the potential for God to use people in my lives to help my life and my wife's life and our family's life to grow in our appreciation and our affection for Christ's love. So Paul says that. So community is another way that God uses it. He goes on to say, in addition to that, that Christ may dwell in your hearts, that being rooted and grounded in love, may have strength to comprehend with all the saints the breadth, height, and depth of Christ's love, to know the love of Christ that surpasses knowledge, that you may be filled with the fullness of God. What he's saying next is, what is the test? What is the indication that you are growing in your appreciation of Christ's love? Well, in a word, it would be godliness, godlikeness. That you find your reactions or your actions, you find your use of words or your lack of use of words, you find yourself emotionally responding in different ways. And all these things are happening not because you planned them, not because you plotted them, not because you're doggedly making yourself do these things. It's happening because God's changing you from the inside out. And you find that, man, a few months ago, when someone would have said something like that to me, I would have never have responded that way. But now I find myself not only doing it, but wanting to do it, and doing it without thinking. See, Paul is saying here that when we grow in our grasp and comprehension and appreciation of Christ's love, then the very likeness of God is being formed in us. That is its evidence. And you find yourself mystified at yourself, shocked by yourself. Again, can only use personal circumstances. I've seen that. Kim would tell you that she's seen that in me, and I've seen that in her. In some ways, we struggle to grow, even after all these years. But in other ways, we've both seen in each other God at work in our lives. At one time, we had 3 teenagers at the same time, 2 of them in college at the same time, private colleges at the same time. And I didn't become an alcoholic. I don't know how we didn't become alcoholics. Having 3 teenagers at the same time, 2 guys and a girl, all A-type personalities. Everybody in our house is an A personality. Even our parrots are A personality. I think we've got a dog that's an A personality. No one lacks in verbiage at our house. It's just a very, very lively place. I remember when one of the elders in one of our church plants, his daughter came to visit our house for dinner. And it wasn't real common for us to do that at that time because we lived in kind of a small place. But when she went back home, her dad and her mom, the dad was one of our elders, said, well, what was it like to have dinner at the Maddox's? And she said, well, you better be on your A game because they're not going to let you jump in without cost. And so, that's my family. They're all just very verbal. There's real good things about that because there's no mystery to what anybody's thinking. But there's also a lot of potential for injury when people are that way. And I have seen in each of our family members growth on that. That's something when someone's core personality begins to change. Not because of an illness, not because of a surgery, not because of something that is traumatic, just simply because God is doing that work. It's a wonderful thing. So that's what Paul says here. Why do we need to change? Well, because knowing Christ's love is probably the most important spiritual need that you and I have. Why do we need to grow in our understanding of Christ's love? Because there is probably no bigger and more common target of our enemy than the love of Christ for us. How do we grow in a knowledge of Christ's love? Well, we pray for each other. I wonder how faithful all of us are to pray for the leaders in our church here. To pray for Dwayne and for Amy, to pray for Ryan Leach and Ryan Buss, and to pray for Dan, and to pray for their wives and their children. I mean, if you and I truly long to be a part of a church that is a powerful, impacting agent in the building of God's kingdom, then how can we not be praying this way for our leaders, our community leaders, to pray for them, that God would show them greater depths of his love for them and his son, Jesus Christ? If you want our church to change and to grow, we ought to all be praying that way. And what about your family? What kind of heartache have you faced? What kind of heartache are you facing? What does the future look like for you in decision making? I know you believe that Christ is Savior and Lord, and I know you trust him. But are you praying that God will prepare you to be the person that he can make you when you find yourself at that crossroad by expanding in your soul the grasp and comprehension that you have of Christ's love for you? See, that's what matters, Paul says here. Remember, he started out saying, I know you're discouraged. I know you're concerned. And he's talking there specifically in context to leadership. But here's what you do. Here's what you need to know. I'm praying that God will show you his love and his son. So that's how we do it. It takes time. It takes circumstances. It takes years. It takes community. It takes failure, I wrote down. It takes restoration, being in a place where your failure has put you in a place to need restoration with others. It takes the kind of failure on someone else's part where you have had to step in and to help them be restored by humbling yourself and forgiving their offense against you. It takes Christ's faithfulness and a conviction that that faithfulness is as reliable as anything that God has created in yours. It takes a sense of Christ's presence in your life. So the last question is, so when, if ever, do we get to that place where we experience the fullness of Christ's love? Well, that's Revelation 21, 1 through 4. And I'm running short on time, so I can't go through it like I just did Ephesians 3, but let me summarize it for you very quickly. Through a revelation from Jesus Christ, John shares with us what it looks like when we find ourselves standing in the presence of Jesus. He describes not just the fact that we're worshiping and all those great things that we'll read later in chapter 21 and chapter 22. He's describing there in those verses the changes that that presence of Christ with us and us with him, what our lives look like at that moment. What is true in ways that it's never been true, and what is not true and will never ever be true again. And it's an awesome picture that is given there. The word love never appears there. But that's exactly what I believe he is describing. This is you in the future when you take in the fullness of Christ's love for you. This is your life, John is sharing with us through the revelation given to him by Christ. And he goes through four different major categories. One, he says, well, all things are new, which is in fulfillment of God's covenant promises, reaching all the way back to the major minor prophets in the historical books. Because when God is finished with the work that he has set out to do, everything is radically changed and changed permanently and unalterably. I guess those are synonyms. Permanently, unalterably, uninterrupted, in an uninterrupted way, in an undiminished way. So he says, it's all changing. And then he gives a few details of what changes when Christ's love is full in our experience. One is, we will never be in the presence of any kind of evil. The term see there, I think is, I would take it as an indicator of hostility, of threat, and of evil, of rage. It's commonly used that way in apocalyptic literature, and I believe it's being used that way here. There will be no more see. There will be no more presence of sin's threat upon you. You will never face again the danger of sinfulness and fault that comes about by fallenness. It's gone, and it's gone forever. You will never again have to contend with your own impurities, your own lust, your own shortcomings, your own weaknesses, your own trepidations. None of that will be there when Christ's love rests upon you in its fullness. God will remove that completely from your life. Another thing he says, that there will be no consequence of temporalness. There will be no more death. There will be no more tears. There'll be no more owies. There'll be no more band-aids. There'll be no more surgeries. There'll be no more tooth decay. I mean, all of that will be gone. Nobody's tonsil gets pulled in the new heavens and new earth. It's all gone. God has obliterated it. And why has he done that? because he has set you and me in the presence of Christ, of the fullness of Christ's love, which controls every inch of our existence at that point. And then the final thing that he mentions, when you know the fullness of Christ's love, God's presence and communion and the sweetness and enjoyment of his presence and communion will be immediate and full. There will be no mediator. There will be no someone standing between you and God or you and Christ. There will be no more spiritual disciplines. Nobody's praying in the new heaven and new earth. Nobody fasts in the new heaven and new earth. Nobody memorizes scripture in the new heavens and new earth. Everything that there is to that God is, you have possession of that knowledge because you have been made and reformed and consummated in his likeness. What an awesome thing that John pictures for us. That when God gets his way and he fully expresses in your presence and in his presence with you, his love, this is how wonderful your life is. Forever and ever and ever and ever. The love of Christ, then, finally, is our hope. It's not just our strength today for endurance and faithfulness and joy and worship and communion and fellowship and forgiveness and reconciliation. It's all those things. But beyond that, way out into the distance, it is where our hope is anchored. This is where God's taking me because he loves me. And because he is the one who knows me best and has the power to do all that he chooses to do, this is the life that I will enter into because of Christ's love for me. What a wonderful picture. What a wonderful existence we will enjoy with one another in the presence of our Lord.